love Jesus. That's 31 in the red book.
I done, dear Lord God. Father, all that he continues to do every day in our lives, Father God, Lord, we just thank you that he makes intercession for us. And Father God, Lord, I just praise you, my Savior God, Lord, for the Spirit that lives inside of me, dear Lord God. The Spirit that guides us in all directions that you need us to walk in, Father. And Lord God, we just praise you, dear Lord God, that he makes intercession for us, dear Lord. That, dear Lord God, that there's often times that I know not to pray, dear Lord, as I ought to pray, dear Lord God. That I just praise you, Father God, Lord, that you know all things and you see all things. And Father, that you have all power. And Father God, Lord, I praise you, my Savior God, Lord, for who you are. And Father God, Lord, I just ask you this morning, Father, that you hear our pleas, dear Lord God, each and every one, Father God, Lord, those that are in the hospital, as Sister Maria mentioned, Father, Lord God, we pray most of all, Father, that you would turn the affliction, dear Lord, that the girl has, dear Lord, that you would turn that for your glory, and that, Father, that she would, Lord, seek you, her family would seek you, Father, that you would just use, dear Lord, these things that come upon folks, dear Lord, for your glory, that, Father, that it would help them to draw close to you. Father, we pray, Father, for Maddie's family, dear Lord God. And Lord, we know that you're still the great physician, and there's nothing too hard for you, Father. Lord God, that all things, dear Lord God, are possible at your hand, Father. And Lord, we praise you for that, my Father God. Lord, thank you ever so much, Father God, Lord, for helping us, dear Lord. And Lord, we pray for our sister's children, dear Lord God. We pray, dear Lord God, that you would continue to use her and use her family and use those that are around them to draw them to you, Father. And Lord God, we just pray, my Savior, that you would just help us, dear Lord God, to be a light and a testimony to the lost, dear Lord God. Help us to live our lives accordingly, dear Lord God, that they might read and see the Bible that's inside of us, Father God, Lord, that they would understand and believe the reality of serving you, dear Lord God, and being your child. And Father, we pray, Father God, Lord, for our sister, dear Lord, that you would just help her, dear Lord, to be strong. Help her to, dear Lord God, I know, Father God, Lord, that all things are possible with you. And dear Lord God, that you give us strength, dear Lord, to be able to do the things that you call us to do, Father, that you always equip us to do all the things that you would have us to do. Father, we pray for Bob and Gail this morning, Father God, Lord, whatever may be the situation they're dealing with, Father. And Lord, we thank you for our military, my Father God, Lord. We thank you, dear Lord God, for a country who still stands for you, Father. And Lord God, we pray, my Father God, Lord, that you would just help and lead and convict the leaders of this country, dear Lord God, that they would turn to you, Father God, Lord, for every decision. And that, dear Lord God, I pray that you keep your hand upon our military, dear Lord God, and keep them safe, Father God. And Lord, I just praise you for the privilege, dear Lord God, that we can gather this morning, Father, in freedom and worship you, Father. And Lord, I just pray that we never take it for granted. And that, dear Lord God, that we would not come, dear Lord God, this morning, dear Lord, to honor and to glorify you, Father. And Lord, I just praise you for that, my Savior God. And Lord, I pray, anoint this service, anoint Robin as she teaches, Father. Lord, help the children's hearts to be open and help our hearts and minds and souls to receive your word, Father. And that, Lord God, that we might be more like Jesus, Father. And that, Lord God, we would redeem the time for the days are evil, Father. And Lord, I'll give you all the praise for all that you accomplish. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
From your burden of sin, there's power in blood, power in blood. Would you, O evil, of victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power. Precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Things are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, in the precious blood of the Lamb.
And sing free too.
Amen.
As well.
I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice, and it told thy love to me. But I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. Draw me near, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me near, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me near, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me near, Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Oh, the pure light of a single hour, and before thy throne I stand. When I kneel in prayer and with thee, my God, I commune as friend with friend. Draw me near, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me near, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. There are depths of love that I cannot know till I cross the narrow sea. There are hearts of joy that I may not reach till I rest in peace with thee. Draw me near, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me near, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side.
Thank you.
say that, because what did I love God this morning? Thank you for saving my soul.
Amen.
For giving me the opportunity and the privilege of being coming to his house this morning, for giving us this beautiful day, for giving me breath to breathe this morning, for waking me up, watching over us through the night. I just want to praise his holy name and thank him for every blessing. I just love coming to church. I love fellowshipping with everyone here. I love everybody here. And I just, I'm so thankful that we had this little church that we can come to and that was glorified God when we come here. Just like the song says, I don't know what you can do, but I can praise him. And I just want to thank him for everything he does.
It's easy to remember to thank God for the obvious things, like being able to wake up this morning in the sunshine, but sometimes we forget to thank God for the things that are not so obvious, like the fact that he gave all the sacrifice for us.
Yeah, amen.
You know, I look around and I see my healthy children, my husband, my home, all the obvious things that I'm blessed with, but sometimes we forget to thank God, and we don't always think about the things that we don't see that we should be thankful for. So I want to thank God for those things that sometimes we take for granted.
Amen. Yeah. God's good all the time, isn't he? Amen. I'm so glad that he is. He's good all the time, no matter what we're going through, no matter our circumstances. The Lord is perfect and holy, and I'm thankful. And I wanted to share something the Lord showed me this week. You know, the Lord does things that never cease to amaze me. I know I shouldn't be amazed because he's God, and I should realize that more, but I just can't seem to get over it, the things that he does, and it just amazes me. You know, we have a little dog, and she's precious to us, you know. The Lord gave her to us to watch over the kids and to be a companion to the kids. And this week, some of y'all know, our little dog ran out on the road, out on Big Collar Road, and crossed lanes and got hit by a car. And she came into the house yelping and crying, and I thought for sure she was going to die. But she's all right. I can't tell there's anything at all wrong with her.
Amen.
I mean, not a thing. And I thought, you know, it amazed me because the very next day, I want to tell you about my God. The very next day, I was on my way to a place I had to go for work, and I was listening to a preacher, and the preacher come on, and he started preaching, and he started talking about that his pets and his family have lived extraordinarily long lives. Now, I've never heard a preacher preach that before. But that happened the very next day after this happened, and he was preaching and testifying about how that his pets, God blessed his pets because of him and because of Jesus. And I thought, well, is there a scripture that says that God would bless an animal because of me? Because I love Jesus? And so I look here in Deuteronomy 28, and the Bible says, and all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee if thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. Blessed shalt thou be in the city, and blessed shalt thou be in the field. Blessed shall be the fruit of thy body, and the fruit of thy ground, and the fruit of thy cattle, and in the increase of thy kind, and the flocks of thy sheep. I don't know about you, but that tells me that God will bless an animal because of me. Because of Jesus living inside of me, that God will bless an animal. And you know, and if God will do this in the physical, which relates to the physical and someone eating, how much more would the Lord bless an animal because of the heart? And I thank God for who I serve today. I thank God for who he is.
Yeah.
That he blesses us in all areas, just as my sister said, areas that I don't even realize from day to day. But he's such a wonderful Savior. And I'm so glad for who Jesus is.
Well, I want to stand this morning and thank God for praising for all the blessings he bestowed upon us down here in our lives. John Slessis was.
with her.
Oh, Isabella, she's had a tumor in her leg. All the time, about a year ago, probably, when she has to go every so often, have x-ray, check all her bone, every time they come back, it's no better. So the other day, she went, come back, and it's better.
Hallelujah, yeah.
Said it, the bone had broke some, and the tumor had shrunk. So, I just want to pray and give you glory, but come on, do that, oh God.
Amen.
And one of my best friend's brother is in the hospital, and he's been, he's really been through his own death and all of that, and feeding tubes, and she said that she went the other day, and he could shake his head, yes or no. Nobody did that but God. The doctor says what they can, but knowledge to do what they can.
That's right.
Amen. Thank you for that this morning. And my sister's 91 years old, and she's not too well. I want prayer for her this morning. Pray for me too.
Amen. Bless you. Bless you, Liam.
And back in the winter, when Nancy was in the hospital real bad, when they operated on him and everything, I really, really got sincere. I mean, I really prayed to God that, you know, that touch him. And I prayed one more time for my last winter before last, where we would sit and watch the through the window of the house and watch it snow. And I prayed that we would get to see that again. So this past winter, we sat at the same spot. We seen the snow just like it did that winter before. Nobody did that but God.
Amen.
And I said, you know, I know he answered my prayer. That right there showed me, you know, that, which I knew he could.
Yes.
But he did. He really, it was just exactly like it was before. So, but anyway, nobody couldn't have done that but God.
Amen.
It wasn't so. Anyway, remember Donzie. I mean, he's still pretty good, but he don't look good. Not gaining weight or anything. He just don't look good at all. But anyway, the Lord's with him. And just remember me in your prayers.
Bless you. Bless you.
Verses 16 through 20. Yep. parts you're going to memorize is going to be 18 through 20. Okay, I'll read a verse, Ray, you read one, then Autumn reads one. We'll just take turns. Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee, into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. Grouchy in me. But we still ask him to help us with things, don't we? How does he act when we ask him to help?
No.
He gets mad and he stomps around. I don't have time for this. So we all respond differently, don't we? We're all different. We all have different personalities. We have different moods. We're in different moods. We have different feelings. We have different strengths. We have different weaknesses. But when we're asked to do something, are those strengths and weaknesses important? Do they really matter? They don't really matter, do they? What does matter? If somebody asks you to help them with something, what does matter? Just do your best, huh? You need to just do the best that you can. And just say, yes, I'm willing to try. I don't know if it'll turn out right, but I'm going to do the best I can. We're going to wanna ask you some different situations. I want you to give you a piece of paper. Write the word yes real big on one side, and write the word no way on the other side. Take a thought. Write yes, great big letters. Starting at verse verse 18. Was their answer? Yes. So the first two men, Simon and Andrew, what was their answer to Jesus asking to follow him? Yes. Okay, now let's go to Matthew chapter 9. What was Matthew's answer? Yes. Okay, Autumn, you read verse 10. Thank you. people were all ordinary people. Matthew, he was working at his job, just like Simon and Andrew, they were fishermen. They were working at their job. There was James and John and their father Zebedee. They were working at their job. They were just ordinary people going about their daily lives. And they may not have thought that they were good enough to follow Jesus. But what did they do? They just dropped everything and said, yes, we'll go, we'll follow you. They put Jesus ahead of their fears. And they're worried, maybe they were worried about their job. You know, I can't leave my job, you know what? This is my job, this is my responsibility. But they left their job and they followed him. Jesus wants us to be like that. He wants us to be willing to do what he tells us to do, to trust him when he gives us instructions for something, to do something even though we might not think that we're good enough, or we might think it's too hard, we might be a little scared. He wants us nervous. He wants us to just say yes. Just do it. Just do what he tells you to do. Yes. Okay, now I want you to turn in 2 Corinthians. One more. Yes. Yeah. It's right after Acts. 2 Corinthians chapter 12.
Flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called.
But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. That's good. So God will choose the weak things of the world. Part of the scripture that we're going to memorize, okay? But we've got a few weeks to do it, okay? So let's read it together a couple times, all right? Wait, let's read the reference first.
Matthew 28:18-20.
And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore, all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Let's go for it one time. Matthew 28:18-20. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Thank you. You think that's too hard for us to memorize? Jesus says, I want you to memorize this. So what do we need to say? Yes, it's not too hard, is it? He'll make us able to do it, won't he?
Ray read the scripture earlier.
Yeah.
So I can do all things.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Where you want to see?
He had the answer to that question.
Yep.
Let's see about the Bible first. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth. 1st and 2nd Samuel, 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, Job, Psalms and Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah,
trip to Mexico, ride a donkey real slow, eat a cheesy taco. I may never wear a sombrero, but I'm in the Lord's army. Si, senor! I'm in the Lord's army. Si, senor! I'm in the Lord's army. Si, senor! I may never take a trip to Mexico, ride a donkey real slow, eat a cheesy taco. I may never wear a sombrero, but I'm in the Lord's army. Si, senor!
Yeah.
Amen. Aren't you glad it just takes a little talk with Jesus?
Yeah.
You know, when Jesus commanded the legion of demons to be cast out of that one, man that was possessed with the demons, it took one word. He said, go.
Right.
And that's all it takes. It just takes one word from God, and it happens.
Amen.
You know, it's impossible for God to lie.
Yes.
Whatever God says, it comes to pass.
Right.
You know, the Bible tells us here in Deuteronomy chapter 7, it says that the Lord did not set his love upon you, nor choose you, because you were more in number than any people, for ye were the fewest of all people. But because the Lord loved you, and because he would keep the oath which he has swore unto your fathers, hath the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand, and redeemed you out of the house of bondmen from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. You know, it's impossible for God to lie, and when God could not swear by any greater, he swore by himself. And amen, God brings to pass what he promises. And I'm so glad, amen, that God blesses us, not because we're such great people, but he blesses us because he wants to perform his good word. God wants to honor his good word. Thou leadest us in the paths of righteousness for thy name's sake. I'm so glad it's for his name's sake that God's with us and God helps us. It's a blessing. That blesses me, knowing that it's because of his name that he guides us and that he calls us. You know, I love that about the fishermen because you know, they could, in those days, those people, the greatest calling that they could do was to be part of the synagogue. In our estimation, it would kind of be like being a doctor or a lawyer or a judge. But these guys had missed it. They weren't able to be part of the Pharisees. They weren't able to reach the mark that the Pharisees and the scribes and the lawyers had put on men. They weren't able to attain to that. They had missed it. So they took the living of their father or their family, and they began doing that work because they had to make a living somehow. And so here came one that was... They called him Rabbi. They called him Master. Here was one who spoke with authority, and he said, come and follow me. Now, isn't it a blessing that God chooses those things? God chooses sinners so that God receives the glory. When he chose the chiefest of sinners, Paul, or Saul of Tarsus, before his name was called Paul, God chose him so that God's glory could be manifest in him.
Amen.
It wasn't so that Saul would continue being Saul, the sinner Saul who persecuted Christians, but it was that he would make him a holy saint of God, and that men could see and marvel at the power of Almighty God. That's the greatest miracle today. It's not the being healed from sickness, or the lame to walk, or the blind to see, or the feeding of the 5,000. It's the new birth.
Amen.
The new birth. Marvel not that I said unto ye, ye must be born again. That is the greatest miracle mankind has ever received.
Oh, that's right.
To be born of the Spirit. Oh, glory be to God. It excites me. Hallelujah. If you would, look with me in Ephesians chapter 5. And last week we studied a little bit about submission, about how we can attain victory in our daily life, and that it was not through trying harder, but it was through submitting more. And now our flesh wants to try harder. And look, I'm not telling you that it's not right to try to do good things, but what I'm saying is that if we will submit ourselves to the Lord, the Lord will guide our footsteps in everything that we do. Everything that we do, cast all of your care upon him, for he careth for you. God will guide us in the right direction and allow us to walk in his power daily. Daily. And it's through submission, submitting to the authority of the Lord. So we see this, the definition of submission is the condition of being submissive, humble, or compliant. And I really like this next one. The action or fact. You see that word action, that's a verb. That's something you're putting into action. The action or fact of accepting or yielding to the superior force or to the will or authority of another person. And well, that person is God. Amen. It's the fact of yielding to God. And or the act of surrendering to a hold by one's opponent. Now, what does that have to do with it? Well, we'll see here. Well, let's take a look. It doesn't matter who you submit to. Does it matter who you submit? Yes, it matters who you submit to. It is so critical who you submit to because of what the Bible tells us here in Romans 6 and 16. Know ye not, in other words, don't you know, is what he's saying. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey. Look with me if you would. Look with me how critical this is. To whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey. So whoever you yield yourself to obey, you're the servant of whom you yield to obey to that person.
Amen.
So when it goes on, it says, whether of sin unto death or obedience unto righteousness. Now Jesus taught in John chapter 8, he said, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the Son abideth ever. If the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed. And the Pharisees, those who were there listening, they said, what do you mean we shall be made free? We were never in bondage to any man. We are of Abraham's seed. And you know what Jesus said to them? He said, you are of your father the devil, is what he said. He said that he was a murderer from the beginning and he abode not in the truth. And he says, and you seek to stone me, a man who told you the truth. Now, Jesus was trying to get them to realize this verse right here. Whoever you yield yourself servants to obey, his servants are to whom ye obey. Whether of sin unto death or obedience unto righteousness. Does it depend? Does it matter if we yield to the world? God doesn't want you to yield to the world. God doesn't want you to yield to the devil. God wants you to yield to him.
Amen.
Amen. You want to have power in your life? Yield yourself to God.
That's right.
Amen. And you'll see the power of God work in your life. Now, we need to ask ourselves a question. Do you desire God's blessing in your life? If you do not desire God's blessing, I don't think you'd be here this morning. I mean, I think it's just a plain and simple fact. Here we see in Genesis 32 that Jacob desired the blessing of God. We need to have a spirit like Jacob. Amen. The Bible said that Jacob was left alone. And you know, some of the greatest revelations you'll ever have is just between you and God.
That's right.
And not necessarily in the church. There's nothing wrong with being, I'm blessed every time I come to church and work. But the greatest blessing you'll ever have is, brother, between you and God. I will commune with the Lord with my heart upon my own bed. Hallelujah. It is a blessing, amen, to spend time alone with God. Jacob was left alone and there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of day.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. He was in the wilderness and he started wrestling a man. Woo. And when he saw that he prevailed not against him, he touched the hollow of his thigh, and the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint, and he wrestled with him. Hallelujah. Jacob was wrestling. He said, let me go, for the day breaketh. And he said, I will not let thee go except thou bless me. Hallelujah. You knocked my thigh out of joint. And but I'm not going to let go because I want to be blessed. Glory be to God. You know who this was? This was El Shaddai. This was Christ before he came. This was God Almighty and pre-incarnate Jesus. And he was wrestling with him and he said, what is thy name? And he said, Jacob. He said, thy name shall no be more called Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince thou hast power with God and man and hast prevailed. And Jacob asked him, he said, tell me, I pray thee, thy name. And he says, wherefore is it that thou dost ask after my name? And he blessed him here. In other words, he says, you know who I am. You know who I am. Hallelujah. Do you desire God's blessing? If you desire God's blessing, amen, I tell you that if you seek God, brother, with all your heart, he'll answer you. And he'll show you, he said, call unto me, and I'll answer thee, and I'll show you great and mighty things, which thou knowest not. That's a promise from God.
Amen.
I desire God's blessing. Look with me, if you would, at Ephesians chapter 5, and we're going to read the whole chapter. If you would, and if you're able, would you stand for the reading of God's word? Be therefore followers of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also hath loved us, and hath given himself for us an offering, a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. But fornication and uncleanness or covetousness, let it not be once named among you as becometh saints. Neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks. For this ye know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man who is an idolater, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no man deceive you with vain words, for because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Be not therefore partakers with them, for ye were sometimes darkness, but now ye are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. For it is a shame to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. But all those things that are reproved are made manifest by the light. For whatsoever doth make manifest is light. Wherefore he saith, awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Wherefore be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. And be not drunk with wine, whereas in excess, but be ye filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself, for no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourisheth and cherisheth it, even as the Lord the church. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother, and shall be joined unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his wife even as himself, and the wife see that she reverence her husband. You may be seated. And let us go to prayer before God. Father Almighty, we praise you, Almighty Father God. Lord, for your holy word, Father God, Lord, that's forever settled in heaven. Lord God, that never changes, Father God. And Lord, I just praise you, Father God, for your precepts, dear Lord God, which make us wiser than all of our teachers, Father God. Lord, for what you have given us, Father. Lord God, I pray this morning that you would hide me behind the cross, that you would anoint my lips as I speak. Help me, dear Lord, to teach clearly. Help me to speak, dear Lord, with authority of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father God, Lord, that we would be submissive to your word, and that, Lord God, that we would grow thereby, Father, to bring you honor and glory to your wonderful, precious name. In the name of Jesus I pray, and amen. The word tells us here many wonderful truths, but one of the things that really stands out is he tells us to redeem the time, for the days are evil. You know, we often go through our lives and we don't regard to how precious each day is that God has made. And God, each day is a day that the Lord hath made. The Bible says, I will rejoice and be glad in it. And brother, we can have daily victory in the Lord Jesus Christ and accomplish many things for His glory no matter what. No matter what the day has been, it's a day that God has made, and we can bring glory to His name if we will simply follow some truths that God has given us. A few truths in this chapter regarding submission. Number one, we see that in verse 21 it says, submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. Number two, wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. And number three, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for us. So these three key areas of this chapter is giving us ways that we can submit. We can submit as Christians. Amen. First of all, we must believe, amen, that this is the infallible Word of God. I pondered all week on having a lesson on submitting ourselves, that this is the Word of God. But I believe wholeheartedly in my heart that you believe this is the Word of God.
That's right.
Amen. And brother, I heard something a while back that if we believe this is the Word of God, then brother, then we should take time to absorb and consume the Word of God and to allow it to dwell richly in our lives and allow it to have an effect on our lives. Now the Bible says in the book of Hebrews that they heard the Word. There were those that heard the Word, but they didn't mingle it with faith. So, brother, in order for the Word of God, in order for you to be blessed, if you really desire a blessing as Jacob desired a blessing, you must take the Word of God and you must apply it to your life. You must use the Word of God in your daily life. Number one here, it says, submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. It is so critical as Christians that we submit ourselves one to another. It is so critical that especially when we are around sinners, amen, I'm so glad that God sees us all the time. I'm so glad He is ever present. And He sees and knows everything, even the thoughts and the intents of our heart. But brother, when we are around sinners, you need to be especially on guard. When you are around someone, brother, not for you, but for His name's sake. You need to be on guard because your enemy goes about as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. He would love to cause you to stumble and fall right in front of a sinner.
Right.
So that he can cause that person to go to hell. Amen. Oh, he certainly would. He would love to cause discord in God's church so that the people down the road can say, well, looky here. They call themselves Christian. The devil rejoices over that. But glory be to God, I tell you, if you're in submission one to another, you won't be full of pride. You won't be full of pride. Brother, the Bible tells us in the book of Galatians, chapter 5, now this isn't in my notes, and I'm thankful for that, amen. But the Bible tells us in the book of Galatians, chapter 5, the Bible tells us, He says about that the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy and peace and long-suffering and gentleness and goodness and faith and meekness and temperance. Against such there is no law, and they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. Glory be to God. He desires for us to be at peace with one another. Hallelujah. That is what the church needs today, is to have peace, love, joy, peace, goodness, gentleness. If one suffers, we all suffer. If one rejoices, we all rejoice. Hallelujah, how precious, hallelujah, how the psalmist wrote, how precious it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Oh, it's like the oil that was poured upon Aaron, and it ran down upon his beard, the Bible says. It's the anointing. When we are together in one accord, and I'm so glad for that this morning. I'm so glad for this little church that we dwell together in unity.
Amen.
And that unity is Jesus. But it tells us here, this is a key truth. This is a key truth to submit ourselves one to another. In God, in the fear of the Lord. Jesus said in John 13 and 35, by this shall all men, he didn't say Christians, he said all men. That means sinners, Christians, everybody. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples if ye have love one for another. Hallelujah. You know that love covers a multitude of sin? It does. Love covers. Brother, many waters cannot quench love. If a man would give all of his substance for love, it would be utterly condemned. Hallelujah. I'm so glad that abide now abideth these three, faith, hope, and charity, but the greatest of these is love. Hallelujah. Though I speak with the tongues of angels and know all prophecies and have all faith that I can remove mountains and have not charity, it profit me nothing. I'm so glad, he says, I become as a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal if I don't have charity. Hallelujah. You can say all kinds of things, but if you don't love your brother, I mean especially those that are the household of faith, there's something wrong. Amen. I thank God for preachers and other churches. Amen. We need to pray for other churches and other preachers and other teachers and other congregations, that the will of God would work and that there would be unity and that the world would get on fire for Jesus and would put away envying and strife and malice and put away all these things and dwell in unity, submit themselves one to another in the fear of God. This is a key. It's a key truth. It's why that there isn't power in a lot of places today. Evidence of love, the Bible tells us in Ephesians 4, let all bitterness, wrath, and anger, and clamor, and evil speaking be put away with you with all malice. Be ye kind one to another, tender hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. Brother, I tell you what, when I realized what kind of a sinner I was, and I realized how God forgave me, brother, I can't hold nothing against anybody. I can't hold nothing against nobody. I can't be bitter about nothing. I'm not going to be bitter about nothing because God forgave me. Amen. It's a blessing. Number two, the bride and Jesus. The bride and Jesus. We're the bride. Amen. The church is the bride of Christ. Just as it tells us here, wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. I'm so glad, amen, to have a Christian wife. I'm very, very thankful. I want you to realize, amen, that how precious it is to have a Christian husband, to have a Christian wife. In Proverbs 31, the Bible says, a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised. Amen. It's wonderful to have a Christian wife. I tell you, brother, it is a blessing. And glory be to God. I'm thankful for a wife that looks at the Word of God and believes the truths in the Word of God and lives by the Word of God. I'm so thankful, amen, that for that reality. It says, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. Now, for a wife to submit herself to her husband as unto the Lord, this is an amazing fact. Because I think that there are many in today's society, especially sinners, that don't understand the role of a wife in the household. There's many people, even Christians, who do not understand the role of a wife in the household. I think that there are many wives who do not understand their role to their husband. Now the Bible tells us here in John 15, the words of our Lord Jesus Christ himself, he says, "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends if ye do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth I call you not servants." I think that there is a great misconception that husbands believe their wives to be servants and wives think themselves to be servants to their husbands. But that's not the way that it is. That is a misconception. It is a resting of the Scriptures. The Bible says that there are those who wrest the Scriptures to their own destruction. Now, brother, glory be to God. I'm so thankful, amen, that my wife is not to be a servant to me. Amen? She's not to be a servant. But glory be to God. Let me ask you, if you were to have someone who was to serve you, say you owned a business, and you wanted someone to, you hired someone to help you, in the Bible they're called servants, okay? And then those who are masters, or there's masters and there's servants, would you rather have a servant to do something out of obligation, or would you rather have someone that loves you as a friend and do it out of love? Brother, I'll tell you, I'd rather have love. Because I know that love conquers all. I know that there is no, that my God himself is love. I would rather have someone, I tell you, brother, that a wife is not to be a servant. When you are, God made you as a helpmeet for your husband. He made you that way to be a friend to your husband. Listen, if you're not a friend to your husband, there's something wrong. There's something wrong. You say, "Brother Troy, you're meddling." No, I'm not. It's the Word of God. This is the Word of God. This is what God wants you to have victory in your marriage and in your home. Do you desire that blessing? God tells us here that he says, "For I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends." I would much rather have someone who does something out of love. I would much rather, amen, I would much rather my wife do something because she loves me, not because she's obligated to do it, but because she loves me. And she's my friend. She's my friend. I can talk with her about things that I would not talk about with anybody else. And her with me. And that's the way it should be in our homes. You know, glory be to God, it made me want to shout coming up the road because I was listening to Claude Spurlock on the way here, and he was preaching about how the devil wants to get into your household and disrupt your marriage and your family. I told Robin, I said, "You mark this. It's no coincidence. It's no coincidence. That is the truth. He would love to wreck your home. He would love for you to think, well, you know what, my husband, he's demanding of this and demanding of that and this and that and he wears me." Listen, brother, don't look at it that way. It's not that you do it out of obligation, but you do it out of love. Because you love him. Why? You're submitting yourself as unto the Lord. This is amazing. "Whatsoever ye do." Now this is speaking to Christians. A sinner can't get this. "Whatsoever ye do," Colossians 3, "whatsoever," brother, that means anything. "Whatever you do, in word or in deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him." Verse 23, "And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily as unto the Lord and not unto men." So whatever you do, wives, in submitting yourself to your husband, do it unto the Lord. And not to your husband. Do it unto the Lord. Amen. That, brother, that gives you a different light on things. You see, when you look at Luke 15, when the prodigal son came back and he said, he had rehearsed what he was going to tell his father, "I'm going to go home and I'm going to tell my father I've sinned against heaven and before thee, no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants." When he came back and he got to his father, he said, "I've sinned against heaven and before thee and no more worthy to be called thy son." He couldn't even get it out of his mouth to be made a hired servant because he didn't want a servant. He wanted a son. Amen. And brother, I'm so glad that a wife isn't a servant. She's my wife. She's my wife. Amen. She does things out of love. Whether therefore ye eat or drink, whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. Everything. Everything. God didn't say some of the things. He didn't say just the things of church. Just when people were watching, he said, do it all. Do it all to the glory of God. Listen, you may have a husband that's sick. You know, when you take vows, it's precious. It is very serious to vow a vow unto the Lord. People don't realize it. When they get married, they don't realize that they are making a vow to God Almighty to love that person, to honor them, to cherish them. Brother, in sickness and in health, for richer or for poorer. The Bible says, he that hath pity upon the poor lendeth unto the Lord, and that which he hath given, he will pay him again. Listen, if you got a husband that's sick, you got a husband that's maybe he's not walking right as he should with the Lord, have pity upon him and lend him the love that Jesus has given you. And you know what? What you lend to him, it's like you're doing it to the Lord. And what you've given to the poor, God's going to pay you back again. Hallelujah. I'd rather be paid back by God than man, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Amen. We don't do it to get paid back. But this is just a simple fact. This is just a simple way that you can't outgive God. You do something and you do it out of honor unto the Lord, and hallelujah, God will make it right in your home. He'll make it right in your family. Glory be to God. You know that you can win a sinner. A wife that is a godly wife can win, bless you, sister, can win a sinner husband unto the Lord. This is the only place in the Bible that I know of. The only place that I know of in the entire Bible that plainly states it, that a wife can win her husband to the Lord without the Word of God. Without the Word of God, a wife can win her sinner husband to the Lord, or a husband that has been fallen to the Lord. 1 Peter chapter 3, likewise, ye wives, be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may without the word be won by the conversation of the wives. Now that word conversation isn't necessarily just how she talks, but it's her actions. It's the way she lives her life. That's the word conversation. While they behold your chaste conversation coupled with fear. What's that fear for? It's not fear toward her husband. Coupled with fear to the Lord. Whose adorning, let it not be the outward adorning or plaiting of hair and of wearing of gold or the putting on apparel, but let it be the hidden man of the heart. Now I underlined and changed that word there to red, that word man. And this is, it's easy to overlook these things, but in the reference of this scripture, it is saying that the wives, and it's talking about the hidden man, it means mankind. That's what that means right there. It's talking about a male, but it's meaning male and female. In the context of the scripture, we can see that this means the hidden man of the heart is talking about the woman of the heart. Not that she's pretty on the outside. Not that she looks nice on the outside. Look, it's the heart is where God looks. Amen, and glory be to God. What you have on the inside, it'll come out. It'll come out in time. When you get saved, God starts making a change, doesn't he? Can anybody testify to that? I mean, when God saved you, he began working on you, didn't he? Philippians 1 and 6, being confident of this very thing, that he hath begun good work and you will perform it unto the day of Christ. Amen. You began putting away these things. You were going this way and you repented and you started going this way. You were living in sin and you started living a holy life. And brother, you can't help for it to come out on the outside. But there's many who look nice on the outside, but inside, their heart's black as coal. Bible says, let it be the hidden man of the heart. Hallelujah. When they brought David there, and Samuel was looking for somebody to anoint, he was going to pour the oil and anoint David's brothers, and he couldn't, it wasn't, the Lord didn't choose this one. Lord, isn't there any other ones? Well, there's this little one out there, and he tends the sheep. He kind of looks like Howdy Doody, a little freckle-faced fella. Yeah, that same little boy slew a giant. Amen. He says, God doesn't look on the outward appearance, but he looks on the heart. The Bible says, and that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and a quiet spirit, which in the sight of God of great price. For after this manner in old time, the holy women also, who trusted in God, adorned themselves, being in subjection. They adorned themselves, or they made themselves beautiful by being in subjection to their own husbands. Even as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters ye are, as long as ye do well, and are not afraid with any amazement. What does that mean there? Listen, it's talking about a husband that's not obeying the word of God. And that you can win him by your conversation being coupled with fear to the Lord. And you don't be afraid of the way he's living his life. You just walk with God. Mark the perfect man and behold the upright. And brother, God will save your husband. Sister, God will save your husband. Brother, save your husband. Sister, God will save your husband. There is a place that God draws a line. The Bible says there in Ephesians 5:24, therefore as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husband in everything. Now we established this lesson in Romans 6:16, where it says, know ye not to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey? His servants ye are to whom ye obey. Listen, if a husband, a sinner husband, or a husband who is outside of, who may be a Christian, may be a believer, but is not walking in the will of the Lord, asks you to do something that's outside of the will of God, you are not to submit to that. You are to submit to the will of God. There is a hierarchy. Know ye not to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey. You're not honoring your husband by honoring his sin. You are to serve the Lord. And in the Bible tells us there, wives be in subjection as to your own husbands as unto the Lord. And to do the things that God would call you to do. Not, God draws a line and God says, look, you don't cross this line. And as it said there in Ephesians 5, it says that we are to not have fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. Now, brother, I tell you this morning, I lie, I tell the truth and don't lie. I'm telling you that it does not matter how dark you make it in here. You could close every window. You could close every door. You could cover up every little crack of light in this entire room. And brother, it could be so dark you couldn't see your hand in front of your face. But all it would take is one little candle, and the darkness has to flee.
That's right.
Just one little candle. That's all it takes. There cannot be so much darkness that the light can't shine. And my God is light, and in him is no darkness at all.
Amen.
And brother, glory be to God. It doesn't matter how dark it is. You let your light so shine before your husbands, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven.
Amen.
Your integrity of the Lord will convict your lost husband's heart. Your integrity to the Lord will save your backslidden husband and get him back on the path he needs to be on. Your integrity for the Lord. Brother, the Bible said when Job was afflicted by Satan, amen, you know there's some sickness that's brought on by ourselves. There's some that happens that comes by Satan. Amen. And glory be to God. The Bible said that his wife said to him, the Lord hath given. She said, won't you curse God and die? And he says, the Lord hath given and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And all this, Job did not sin, but he held his integrity. You have hold your integrity no matter what comes upon you. And listen, it'll save your family. It'll save your family. Frustration, anger, and resentment, they only make it worse.
They only make it worse. Submit yourself to God. Submit yourself to your husband. Do you ever, when you get in an argument, and I know that this is a rhetorical question, but do you ever get the attitude of, I'm going to get even? Do you ever get your husband make you mad, wives? You know, I'm going to get even with him. You won't say it out loud. You won't say that out loud. Now, come on. I wouldn't say it out loud. You might say it out loud, but I don't think you'll say it out loud. You know what the Bible says now in Psalms 14, that the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. There's things that we'll say in our heart, but we won't say it audibly, and we'll think it, and we'll even act out on it. We'll get an attitude of getting even. Do you know what it means to get even? When you have maybe you have a lost husband, or maybe you have a backslidden husband, or a husband that's not walking in the will of God, or a husband that is just downtrodden, he's so oppressed of the devil, he can't even get up out of the muck and the mire. And here you are, you're praising God. Ladies, you're filled with the Holy Ghost. You are serving God and you're worshiping God, and your husband says some mean thing to you. He does some terrible thing to you. No, I won't get even. I won't fix his dinner. I'll make it cold. I'll give it to him cold out of the refrigerator, and I'm not going to even want to heat it up. And you get this idea that you're going to get even. Well, let me show you an illustration here. You see this woman over here on this side? She's praising God. She's up on the mountain. This guy here, he's a sick and a weary husband sinner. Now, do you want to get even with that? Do you want to come down from this and get even with that? You don't want to come down to that level. You want to stay on the mountain. And you want to glorify God and praise God and worship God. And I tell you, your integrity for the Lord will save your husband. It'll bless your home. God will work in your life, brother, because of your submission. God resists the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. The more you submit to Him, God will show unmerited favor in your life, wives. God will convict his heart. He can do it in a dream. He can do it when he's by himself. He can do it when he's up on the mountain somewhere going fishing. God can work on your husband's heart. Get his heart right. And it's not something that you have tried to do. It's not something you have worked at doing. All you have to do is say, glory be to God. I'm going to worship Jesus. I'm going to raise my hands. I'm going to clap my hands. I'm going to say, hallelujah, my God reigns. He's supreme. I'm going to give Him glory. I'm going to let Him take care of the battle. Amen. The battle's not yours, it's God's. Amen. He finished it already. He finished it already at Calvary. Now we see from the other side. We see from the other side, not the bride and Jesus, but Jesus and His bride. Hallelujah. Amen. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. You see, now I read some commentaries and things on this. I didn't agree with all of it. I'm not condemning anyone, but I didn't agree with all of it because it was talking about how that, you know, wives are supposed to be doing this thing and that thing in the home and the finances and this and that and the job and all that. Look, I don't think that's what this is about. I don't think that's what this is about. I think this is talking in spiritual terms. You see, because I think God is concerned with the spirit inside of us. I think God's concerned with our hearts. You see, God, the Bible said in Genesis 2 and 16 that the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. And the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helpmeet for him. Now in the context of this scripture, we can see that when God's talking about the man, he's talking about male. He's talking about Adam. So we see that he makes the woman later. But the commandment in the Garden of Eden came to the man. The commandment came to the man. God did not speak and tell Eve. God told Adam. Brother, I want to say something today, and I'm thankful that God has given us a way to put this on YouTube. I'm going to say something. I believe that the problem with our households, the problem with America, it's not the president, it's not Congress, it's not the banks, it's not the businesses or the stock market. The problem with America begins in the household. It begins with the head of the house. That is the problem with America. That is the problem with a country that has turned from God. It begins with the head of the household. Because what did the Bible tell us there? That the husband is head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church. It's not the head that the husband, oh, he's the one that has to, he controls all the finances and he controls all of the decisions. And no, brother, God wants you as a husband to step up and to be a man and amen, get on fire for Jesus and hallelujah, follow him with all of your heart and soul and mind and strength and hallelujah, see the glory of God reign supreme in your household. That is the problem with this country. Is that men, God gave man the commandment, and it was man's duty, to give it to his wife. It was man's duty. It is man's duty, just as it is man's duty today, it is man's duty to be the spiritual leader in your household. The husband is head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church. Who is the head of the church? Who is the great shepherd? It's Jesus. Jesus is the great shepherd. He is the head of the church. He is the one who inspires me or inspires you to testify or inspires Robin to teach. It is Jesus who is the head of the church. Bless you, son. Bless your heart. The husband is the head of the wife. Even as Christ is the head of the church, he is the savior of the body. You as a husband, you are the savior. God is typing you as a savior of your household. Hallelujah. That is a wonderful responsibility. It is a wonderful responsibility. It is, and you know what? If God has called you to be responsible for that, you know what that means? He's going to equip you to be responsible for that. God's not going to tell you that you need to do something and then not give you the means to be able to do it. He has commanded it from the very beginning that you are to give the word to your home. You are to walk in the word. Let me ask you a question. Has Jesus ever demanded anything of the church? Jesus commanded things, but he never demanded and said, you do this or else. I'm not. Jesus, that is not my Jesus. He wants things to be done out of love. Love. We love him because he first loved us. Oh, how I love Jesus. I don't do it because I'm obligated. You know what that is? That's religion. If I do something because I feel obligated to do it to Jesus, that's religion. I'm trying that. If I'm doing it like that, that means that I'm trying to work my way to heaven. And I want you to know you cannot work your way to heaven. Because it's already been paid for. Jesus already did it all. How could I add anything to what he did in dying for me? For taking my stripes when they beat him. For it should have been me whose bones were pulled out of joint and nailed to that old rugged cross. How could I add anything to that? Glory be to God. He's never demanded anything. He wants us to do things out of love. I think that many people get things turned around the wrong way. They, well, if I can work and be good and I can right all my wrong, then I can be pretty good and I can be better than that Christian down there and I'm surely going to heaven then. Brother, don't you count on it. The rich man opened his eyes in torments and seen Lazarus afar off. Listen, the reason why the Bible tells us here that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. He has called husbands to sanctify their household. How? By the washing of water by the word. You know what came from Jesus' side when they pierced his side? It wasn't just blood. It was blood and water. It was blood and water. Hallelujah. Except a man be born of the Spirit and of water, he shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. It's the Word of God, not corruptible seed, but incorruptible. The Word of God, amen, is what washes your home. Jesus said, and now ye are clean by the Word which I have spoken unto you. The Word of God, hallelujah, you can speak it in your home, speak it to your children. Bless your heart, Maria, for singing to your little baby boy. Hallelujah. Sing that Word, preach that Word, teach that Word, walk that Word, live that Word in your home. And I tell you, it will not return void, but it will accomplish that which God has sent it to do, brother. It will accomplish that which He pleases, the Bible says. That He might present it to Himself a glorious church. Hallelujah. Not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but it should be holy and without blemish. Do you realize that this is the commission God has charged you with, husbands? Do you realize that this is something that God has said, look, I'm going to equip you with the Word. I'm going to equip you with the Spirit. It is your responsibility. You can't change it. It is how it is set forth in the Word of God. You are responsible for your household to lead your children and your wife in the path that they should go. You are to be an example. You are the savior of your household. And if it'll start there, if it'll start in the household, this country will get right. It's not, you know, glory be to God. Now, I hear a lot of times people will put fault at those who are doing the work. They'll blame those who are doing the work, but you know what? You know where ultimate responsibility is? It's with the head. It's with the leadership. It's with the leadership. It's not those that are doing the work. They're working themselves half to death. And the leader will end up blaming those that are doing the work. It's not the ones that are doing the work's fault. It's the leadership. The leadership needs to be right, as it should be in the household. As Joshua said, choose you this day whom you shall serve. Amen. Whoever we yield ourselves service to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey. Whether obedience unto righteousness or sin unto death. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Amen. We're going to serve the Lord with all of our heart. Amen. I want to be an example. You know what the Bible says in James? Be not many masters. Brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. You know what that means? And if you're in leadership, if you have, how that means according to this lesson today, that if you have taken a wife and you have began a family, but you know what? You have taken on the leadership of a master. You have taken on the role as the head of your household. And he says, be not many masters. In other words, don't just jump right into this thing, because there is a greater judgment that comes upon you. There is a greater judgment that comes upon you as the head of your household. There's a greater judgment. There's a greater judgment that comes upon you. In Acts 16, Paul and Silas were thrown into prison for preaching the Word. Hallelujah. I heard a preacher the other day, he was talking about, he says that he went to a church, and they're looking for a pastor, and he says, well, I got the perfect pastor for you. He's a little old, but he's got some physical infirmities. He's not very well off physically. He's sickly a lot. And to mention, he's been thrown in jail a couple times. We don't want that kind of preacher. And he says, well, you couldn't have him anyway, because he's the Apostle Paul. He's the Apostle Paul. He's in heaven. Amen. Hallelujah. Paul and Silas were in prison, and at midnight, they shook God. Hallelujah. He shook that prison and the jail cell doors opened. And hallelujah, that guard, that keeper of the guard, he said, he pulled out his sword. sword and was going to fall on it and kill himself because he knew that he had been had. But Paul said, sir, do thyself no harm, for we're all here. They didn't take off running as soon as the jail cell door opened. They sat there. Hallelujah. They knew God was in that place. They weren't afraid. The Bible says that he brought them out and he said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? He asked him, he said, what must I do to be saved? And you know what Paul and them told him? He said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thine house. Listen, if you are following God Almighty, it is a given, proven, demonstrated fact that if you follow the Lord thy God with all of thy heart and with all of thy mind and with all of thy strength, He'll save your house. He'll save your children. He'll save your whole family. The Bible says here that they spake unto him the word of the Lord and all that were in the house. And he took them that same hour of the night and washed their stripes and was baptized, he and all his straightway. And when he had brought them into his house, he sent meat before them, and they rejoiced, believing in God with all his house. His entire household was saved because of one man's act of obedience and submission unto the Lord. God can do this. Listen, if you're not where you should be with God this morning, I encourage you to submit yourself to God. Wives, if you're not submissive to your husband as unto the Lord, listen, you get tired, he wears you out. Listen, you can submit yourself unto the Lord for your husband. You can submit yourself unto your husband as to the Lord for the Lord's sake. And listen, God will bless that act of obedience and submission. No, you don't submit to sin. You don't submit, don't cross that line. But you submit unto Him as unto the Lord, and God will bless that act. Husbands, maybe you haven't been up to par to where you should be in leading your household. Maybe you haven't been the savior of your home. Listen, I want you to know, you can't try enough to get God's blessing. God wants you to submit. God wants you to submit. And if you'll submit to Him, you'll see God's power work in your home, in your life, in your family. God will bless that act of submission. If you would, let's look at page 111 in the Red Book and sing a song called I Surrender All. All to Jesus I surrender. All to Him I freely give. Have you surrendered all to Jesus? Maybe you've surrendered most everything. Maybe you surrendered and you believe. But brother, are you living the Word of God according to His will and His plan? I tell you, that's the only way you'll be blessed, is allowing His Word to work in your life and in your home.
I
In this place today. I'm thankful for him and for each and every one of y'all. I really enjoy the testimonies and the singing and this opportunity to be able to share God's word. It's a privilege. It's the greatest privilege I've ever known in my life. And does anybody have anything that they want to add, anything they want to say for the service? Is this all right? Is this good for y'all? Is this helping?
Amen.
It does? Amen. Does the screen and things help?
Yes.
Amen. I want to be a blessing. I desire to be a blessing, and I desire your prayer. Because I need God's direction. I can't do anything on my own. And Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. So I want to be a blessing. I want to help. And I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that through surrendering to God's word, but that's the key to victory. There's no doubt in my mind that God's word will give us victory in our lives if we'll mix faith along with it. All right, Brother Jim, would you lead us?
Praise the Lord
for his mercy and earth forever.
Praise the Lord for his mercy and earth forever.